Hey yo, it's True Soul Davis, and you're listening to the Truth Talk Show. Hey yo, K.
You ready, baby?
The Truth Talk Show.
Where we listen to music and entertain your ears.
The Truth Talk Show.
Current events and business, what you need to hear.
The Truth Talk Show.
When we turn it up and you need to turn down.
The Truth Talk Show.
If you listen to this, you know what's going down.
Now, you're listening to the Truth Talk Show.
Welcome to the Truth Talk Show. I'm the host, K the Truth. Google me, www.kthetruth.com. In studio today, we have the one, the only, the fabulous, Mr. Freeway Rick Ross. Hey, Freeway.
Hey, how you doing?
Doing great. You know what, Freeway? After
what's
all
that?
These years, you still have people wanting to be a Freeway Rick Ross.
I don't blame them.
I was going to say, what does that mean to you when people say they want to be like you?
Well, you know, I have a different way of thinking than most people. I have a way of looking at a situation and analyzing it and figuring out what should be done. And most people can't do that. Most people are what they call, they follow the herd, and they're not the leaders of the herd. And I've always wanted to be a leader of the herd.
Right on. And a leader you are. So even though you don't have a degree, you ran a nearly $1 billion business a year. $900 million. You ran it from state to state, coast to coast. You were doing it. So I have to say this. I want to be like a Freeway Rick Ross and get my business empire going the way you did. Because that's amazing to me.
Well, you know what? And I've almost cracked the system again. You see my documentary on Netflix called Crack the System.
Wait a minute, you got a couple of things going on YouTube, book, write-up, documentaries. You just doing it. So it's so much to watch of you because you that master, you know, the boss.
No, I ain't no master. I enjoy working. You know, I don't want to sit around and watch TV. I don't want to be at Lil Wayne's concert, and nothing against Lil Wayne or any other guys who make great music. I would rather be somewhere figuring out how I could make life better for me and my family.
If you're not dealing with Kay, it ain't the truth.
Okay, I got to stop you because you know on the Truth Talk Show, we do nothing but tell the truth. And you said a buzzword. You said rapper. So now I got to put you on the hot seat just briefly. I'm not going to burn you up. I'm just going to let it simmer a little bit. So when I think rapper, I think rapper Rick Ross. So what is the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about a guy who's taken your name and used your name to build his success? I just want to know.
Thief.
That sums it up in one word. And hey, I can't blame you because you know I do my research, honey. And I did see where you was trying to say that, you know, basically he stole it. You had a lawsuit out about him, and I think I would have did the same thing. Because everybody knows that Rick Ross started off as a security guard, so he has no real credibility in the streets. Well, so the streets say, but yeah.
I totally agree with that scenario. But at the end of the day, you know, too, I respect what he did from a street level because you know, street cats steal and cheat and lie and you know, it's all kind of hustles on the street. So you know, what he did was smart in a way. He found a product that was kind of abandoned at the time. You know, because I was incarcerated and didn't have access to use my own identity. At that time, I was working on ways to use it while I was in prison, and that's why I was studying and doing all the things that I was doing because I knew that I had an asset that had value. My goal was to get myself in a position to where I could use that value. Because a lot of times we have value, but we don't know how to use that value. So often, people with value don't really even understand that they have value.
Right. And when you said you were in the prison studying, which a lot of people don't know, or they may do, that when you started this empire before you were incarcerated serving a life sentence, you actually could not read. And you were in the process, before they figured out you couldn't read, you were going to receive, or you had received, a tennis scholarship.
Yes. Even though I couldn't read or write, I was still able to put myself in positions of benefit. Had I knew the basic techniques to studying, to reading, to writing, and those things, would have put me in a different position in life.
Right on. This is a side question. With you being able to receive a college scholarship and not being able to read, what were your viewpoints on the education system? How do they let so many kids slide through the cracks and do that? What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, I spoke a couple weeks ago for the first time to the faculty at a school. And one of the things that I told them was that I understand so often we do what we call a stepping stone. You know, we do something just for right now. This is not what I really want to be doing. But I ain't in a position to do what I really want to do. So I'm going to do what I have to do right now to pay my bills and keep gas in the car and clothes and food on the table. And so often that stepping stone becomes the career. And that's happening with our teachers. And so what winds up happening is the teacher is not really focused on the kids being brilliant and dynamic. The goal becomes, I get my check every Friday, and
right,
I'm able to pay rent and feed my kids, and not the goal of turning out brilliant people.
Well, brilliant, I would say you definitely are from running. I just got to go back to this empire from St. Louis, New Orleans, Texas, Oklahoma, Connecticut, North Carolina, South Carolina, Seattle, Baltimore, and cities in between. So even though you were not able to read, you did what was possible, what you had to do to get to the next level. When you were in prison, what prompted you to want to learn to read?
Well, God told me that the way out of prison was through the law library.
The law library, you discovered that they had you under the three strike rule, and really, it wasn't three strikes.
Right. Well, correct. You're absolutely correct. They had me sentenced under the three strike law, but I wasn't a three striker. Technically, I wasn't a three striker. I mean, if you looked at my case, you could say, yeah, you had three convictions, but three convictions doesn't make you a three striker. It has to be consecutive convictions.
So let me, okay, break it down for me and the people who really, you know, may not understand the law.
You have to commit a crime, go to prison, get out, then commit another crime, go to prison, and get out. Then you got two strikes. When you commit that third one, you can get life without the possibility of parole. I mean, it's bad enough that they...
So there's really no break in between.
No, it is break in between. It is break in between. The break in between is what makes it a strike and not a strike. In my situation, they indicted me in several states, and I went to court in different states at different times, but I had never got out of prison, and that's the difference.
Oh, gotcha.
And it's like, say for instance, you know, when you get a whooping,
mm-hmm,
and they whoop you and they say, don't do that no more, then you've been,
yes,
warned. And then if you do it again and they whoop you,
yes,
that's two. But in my situation, I had already did three or four things, and I got a whooping for all of them at the same time.
Got it. So yours was simultaneously. It wasn't like you started, you stopped, you started, you stopped, that type of thing.
Correct.
They did it all in one lump sum.
Oh,
now,
you got it.
Okay, makes sense.
Got it. It's called concurrent and consecutive.
Got it.
So in my situation, my sentences were ran concurrent, meaning they all ran together. I did my time for one as I did the time for the other one. And they weren't intervening arrests. And those are the key words, intervening arrests and consecutive and concurrent. Our people don't want to know about all that stuff, all that law stuff, though. That's some complicated stuff. They want to know about how to get some money.
Well, we don't talk about that, but, hey, they need to know about the law, too, because you, hey.
Not if they got money, because if they got money, and guess what? If they got money in their pocket, they ain't going to commit no crimes.
I don't know, child.
You know, who you know had a bag full of money going rob the bank?
Well, you know what? I'm gonna say it like this: we have several celebrities who have millions of dollars and they still steal. I don't know. They do dumb stuff all the time.
Who?
From
which one? Give me a name of one.
Oh Lord, you gonna make me Google? But and we also
I don't believe that. That would be going against my whole theory.
Okay, you don't know about like the football players? They got the millions and then they turn around and they sell drugs.
Oh no 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 no! They're supposed to have millions. It's a difference.
Supposed to.
It's a difference in having millions and supposed to have millions.
Facts.
So a lot of times they'll put them on TV, you know, and tell you, oh, he's rich, he's powerful, because they want you to go out and buy his tennis shoes that the white man really owns and go to his football games. The white man owned the team, too. And then the little brother, you know, they let him drive the car and, you know, and use the house and wear the jewelry. And then you all of a sudden come in your mind that he's rich.
Okay, well, since we're talking about money, I'm going to get off your path a little bit, because we know that Mr. Freeway Rick Ross knows how to get to the checks, to get to the coins, get to the money. So
yeah,
I heard that at one time you was even doing, like now, like real estate, weave. You was selling weave at one time. I mean, what is it you don't do?
Well, I ain't going to never sell cocaine again.
Right? I know that's right. So,
I bet you I got that right. Hey, I bet I got that right.
We don't want you going back at all. So how many?
No, we're not. We're not. You asked me what is it that I don't do, and I told you that's one thing I'm never going to do.
And we don't want you to do that. Trust me.
Thank you. We're on the same page.
Because, I need you to help me progress. Because you know what? Those skills that you have, I need to soak up some of that smartness, that energy, that brain power, and try to get to that Rick Ross level.
I got you.
So that's what I'm on. But I want to talk about some of your books and your projects. Like right now, what do you have coming down the pike?
Well, you know the book is already out, Freeway Rick Ross Untold Autobiography. I'm still working with that. I just come from Oakland, selling it last night, so that's here. What else I'm doing? You know, I'm in the cannabis industry for social equity here in LA and Oakland. I was up in Oakland last night for a social equity project that we're pushing. I'll be shooting my movie this summer.
It's going to be named Rick Ross, the Rick Ross movie?
The working title is called The Untitled Rick Ross Story. So that's the working title. That's the title that everybody, all the producers, Reginald Hudson, Geno Taylor, Skip, that's the title that everybody's using right now.
Okay, that's going to be hot. I'm sure that's going to be like a blockbuster. Everybody cannot wait to see it.
I better do better than Black Panther. They better come see the real. They went and seen some fake. Now they better come see some real. A real black hero. We got a real black hero.
Mr. Ross, you are not going to have me screaming with laughter, but you're right. I just love this confidence that you have, because that's right. You are.
You know why my confidence is so high?
Why?
Because I work so hard.
So tell us about these jobs that you have, because you have a lot of stuff going, and some I might consider you to be Jamaican, Haymon, because you did.
I need some help, though. I need some help. Right now I'm looking for some help. I'm starting an art department in my company, so I'm looking for graphic artists, designers, stuff like that. I think I'm going to do some more books. I'm probably going to wind up starting my own book publishing company. I was with Ricky Williams yesterday. I'm going to help him put his book together. I think his book will be amazing. They need to know about that. You know how they messed him out of a $60 million contract because he smoked marijuana.
Banging hip-hop and R&B.
Drop it, boy!
On Pure Truth Radio. Powered by Pure Truth DJs.
Okay, I do have to get back to the drug thing. I'm sorry. Because, okay, this is my whole thought on the crack, the weed, and all that stuff. Which we already know that the government was putting people, I'm going to say name of people of color, but people that do drugs in jail. And now here we are, you know, selling it, which we all know that black people have no planes. So we know it had to come from somewhere. So even like you went to prison for selling crack, I still feel like people have a choice. it's still a business. To me, I think that all the drug dealers should be out, and they need to focus more on those people shooting up in the schools. Matter of fact, the police that do police brutality, they need to be in jail. I totally agree.
Don't get me started. One of the things about that, what happened is that police didn't get any rankings in the 80s and the 90s for catching somebody, for shooting and killing somebody. You would get more of a bonus if you caught a drug dealer, you know, with $200,000 or $300,000. You would get a bonus. But if you catch a somebody who shoots somebody and kills somebody, more than likely they didn't have any money. So you don't really get any benefit from that. So
right.
What wound up happening is that at the round table, everybody was focused on catching a drug dealer so they can catch the money and get the bonus.
Got it.
Why should I catch somebody that shoot and kill somebody when it's not going to get me anywhere in my career?
Right.
And it doesn't
take
care.
Well, let's fast forward to now, though. They still need to let the drug dealer, to me, I don't do drugs, but I just look at it like this. They need to let those people out, because it's people out here who deserve to be in jail. I mean, because it's still a choice. If you look at the doctors that give the patients the wrong medicine and they kill people, you don't see them in jail.
No, I totally agree with you. But I'm just giving you the psychology behind the system.
Right.
Not saying that drug dealers should be in jail, because I don't think so either. Most drug crimes are economical crimes, not crimes of ill will or vindictiveness or nothing like that. Most drug crimes are economical crimes, so they should be treated as such. I'm just telling you the philosophy of this country and police force about dealing with drugs and violence.
Okay. So I wanted to go back to your book. Well, actually, what is it? Freeway Rick Ross, Cracking the System, and Freeway Rick Ross, The Untold Autobiography. And all three of those books you wrote, correct?
Freeway Rick Ross, The Untold Autobiography, I wrote that in prison. Cracking the System, we didn't have a script. We kind of just went off the limb, you know? We were just, like, throwing stuff on the wall. And it was my life, so I didn't have to have no script. I knew what had happened. So we
right.
just started putting it together like I saw it, and you know what you see on Netflix right now is what came out of my little peanut mind.
No, it's definitely not peanut. We know this.
The Flame Show, the Truth Talk Show, the Ladies Answer, World of DJs, and the Street Show, all powered by the Truth Talk Show.
Mr. Rick Ross, tell me something that we have not discussed that we should know, or you want us to know.
So I know that we all should know that there's a census that's been put out that says black people in 20 years will be flat broke. They say right now the average black family doesn't have $1,700 in savings, and I don't like it.
I don't either, because I don't want to be a victim.
And I want to do something about it.
Well, you can start by helping me.
Yeah. Well, you know what? That's what we're going to do. We're going to start off with you and me. We're going to start writing. I'm going to show you how to become a famous writer.
I would love to do that, actually.
Well, I'm going to allow you to do that. We already started already today. I put you in line today a little bit.
Yes, you did. And Mr. Rick Ross, what would you tell the kids who are looking up to you, who want to be like you as far as selling drugs? What would you tell them?
Watch me now. If you thought I did something when I sold drugs, you remember I had never read a book. I was only in my early 20s. Now I've read over 300 books. I've traveled the country. And I'm going to do some things that's going to be dynamic. Well, I'm already doing things that's dynamic. I'm going to go back a little bit, you know, and because I try to stay modest. But I've already done some pretty dynamic things, and my goal is to do even more.
Tell us a little bit about your work ethic. Like, when you ran the drug empire, how were you able to stay focused to keep everything running, like, smoothly? And how are you applying that technique to your businesses of today?
Well, I don't do anything half-assed. Excuse my French. If I do it, I want to do it to the fullest. Otherwise, I'd rather not be involved. So when I sold drugs, I went at the drug business full steam ahead. And when I go at other businesses now, I go at them full steam ahead. I don't want to be in nothing where I ain't putting it all on the line. You know, I understood when I sold drugs that I could go to prison. I understood that I might have to kill somebody or that I might get killed.
Right.
And I was still willing to put those things on the line for my success. And what I did is I take that same determination and same focus, and I use it right now. But I don't want to get killed, and I don't want to go to jail, and I don't want to kill anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So I took those three elements out of my game, and that puts me in a space where I'm fairly safe. I mean, you know, you still can get killed here in America because somebody could, you know, I could go to my kid's school one day to pick my kids up and some crazy guy with a gun could come in and shoot me up. So there are still some crazy things, but I am not going to be putting myself at that type of risk anymore.
Name two things that you actually regret from your past.
I have no regrets, only lessons.
That's a good way to look at it. Everything is a learning lesson.
Yes. So anything that I would have done yesterday, I'll do it tomorrow.
And now this is getting back kind of back in the past. When you think blending, what comes to mind? Are you able to trust after that situation? Because you trust him. You know, you spent time with his kids.
I trust people every day. I never lost my trust for people. I still have confidence in people. I understand that we're going to run into some people who go through something in life and they might be having some issues with themselves where they're not trustworthy or a number of things. But at the end of the day, that doesn't stop me from trusting my brother, my cousin, my friends who've never crossed me. And I never go into a relationship with the attitude of this person is going to beat me or this person is out to get me. I never go into a situation with that mindset. My attitude is always when I go into a situation that the situation is going to work out just the way I want it.
No excess baggage. When you talk about your cousins, maybe your family, what does your family think about you then versus now? Is it still the same? Do they still feel the same way about you?
Well, you know how people are. What have you done for me lately? You know.
Oh God, yes we do.
If you haven't had any success lately, then they have very little confidence in you. As your success starts to rise, so will their confidence. Right now, in my family, their confidence in me is starting to rise. You know, I can tell by more and more of them are starting to come around and lend a hand than before.
Don't you think that's the saddest thing? Even though I don't have as much money as you or what you used to have, when people think you moving and shaking and moving, they will come out of the woodwork. And I always think, where were you when I was struggling?
Well, that's the way society is based on. People want to be around people successful. That's kind of the problem that we're having right now as black people, is that these people have gave us people who they make to look to be successful, and we cater to these people. You know, we buy their product. We do everything we can. We'll go to their concert and pay $1,000 to go see them rap. And these people are really not successful because if they were successful, then the black race would be doing better.
Do you still have ambitions of doing a clothing line, staging a prize fight, and doing a mixtape?
I do have my clothing line out already. I have about four different T-shirts. Just came out with my first sweatshirt, which I'm really, really proud of. I'm going to be having a conference call in a couple weeks as well for other people who want to become part of my clothing line with me, because I'm getting ready to set up a distribution chain. It's going to be crazy. Right now I have a heavyweight fighter that's 9-0 that I'm a consultant. I have two middleweights, I think. One is 139 pounds and the other one is 140. One is 5-0, and one is 8-3 that I'm working with. So I'm doing prize fights. So yes, I definitely still plan on doing all those things.
Okay, shout out the clothing line. What's the name of the clothing line?
Freeway.
And we can get it online?
Yes, they can go to my website, freewayrickross.com, and pick up the clothes. And I'm coming out with new stuff. I'm also looking for designers. I'm looking for artists, you know, that can design. I'm also getting ready to start, if it's a rapper or something like that, where I'll be designing shirts for them as well, and helping them do their clothing line as well.
No, that's going to be hot. And so where can we see your fighters? I would love to interview them on the Truth Talk Show.
Well, me and you gonna do. We gonna do a story together on my three fighters. We're gonna do a story. We're gonna title it something like, "Can these three fighters bring boxing back to LA?"
Okay, I'm looking forward to that.
I'm definitely gonna be introducing you to them.
Awesome. Before we sign off, Mr. Freeway Rick Ross, I want you to give the audience 5 tips. Business tips that can help to take their brand to the next level.
Okay, the first one would be go get my book.
Right?
Then I would recommend that everybody read Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, The Richest Man in Babylon by George Clasky, and As a Man Thinks by James Allen. The last tip would be is to always invest in yourself. There's no better place to invest than in yourself. And there's many different ways that we can invest in ourselves, you know, with saving our money, reading a book, finding good mentors to mentor us, and starting mastermind groups.
Right on. Well, I believe in everything you said, especially going back to reading. Hey, they always say put it in a book and a black person will not find it because we're not going to crack it open. But I do believe you have to invest in yourself, promote yourself. Because if you don't invest in yourself or promote yourself, you're not going to win because nobody's going to do it for you. And, of course, you're listening to The Truth Talk Show with your girl, Kay The Truth. If you're not dealing with Kay, it's definitely not the truth. Until next time, find me on Pure Truth Radio. Google me, www.kthetruth.com. And until next time, bye-bye.
If you're not dealing with Kay, it ain't the truth.